If you're LGBTQ+, or know someone who is, our new project, Queerlay, is for you. I'm lead reporter Caitlin Hernandez. Join me and let's tell our stories of queer joy on the LA Report on las.com/queerla. I'm Caitlin Hernandez, the lead reporter for our new project, Queer LA. Over the next year, we'll help you discover new things, find more queer friends, and figure out big life decisions on the LA Report and las.com/queerla.
LAist Studios.
Today on the LA Report, a new report highlights the significant medical debt that is burdening hundreds of thousands of Angelenos. Los Angeles County supervisors approve a new music therapy program for its troubled juvenile halls.
Part of our charge is just to bring down the general tension.
And decades after his death, Tupac Shakur is getting a star in Hollywood. Good morning. It's Wednesday, June 7th. I'm Suzanne Whatley, and you're listening to the LA Report from LAist 89.3. More than 800,000 people in Los Angeles County are struggling to pay medical debt. LAist senior health reporter Jackie Fortier says a new report finds that these bills can have striking consequences on people's financial, physical, and mental health.
The numbers are staggering. 1 in 10 adults in LA County are in debt for medical care, and together they owe at least $2.6 billion. And the impacts can be devastating, says Dr. Naaman Shah, director of medical affairs at Public Health and one of the report's researchers.
Respondents who had burdensome medical debt were less likely to fill their prescriptions, less likely to go for follow-up care. It's a terrible situation where the sick get sicker.
People without health insurance were much more likely to have burdensome medical debt, but sky-high deductibles and out-of-pocket costs mean many people with insurance are struggling. The report also found that people with children were 37% more likely to have medical debt than child-free adults. For LAist 89.3, I'm Jackie Fortier.
You can find more about the cost of medical debt in LA on our website, LAist.com. Happening today, Metro's Taxpayer Oversight Committee on Measure M is meeting to provide updates on how funding from the measure is being spent. Today's presentation will go over Metro's active transportation program, which includes a complete Los Angeles River waterway and system bike path. LA County voters approved Measure M back in 2016, which is a half-cent sales tax that funds projects to ease traffic, repair local streets and sidewalks, expand public transportation, and more. To attend the meeting virtually or to submit comments, you can go to the Metro Board website. Los Angeles County will bring more arts programming to its troubled juvenile detention facilities in the form of a drum corps program. LAist's Robert Garova has more.
The LA County Board of Supervisors approved a $500,000 contract with the Inner City Youth Orchestra Los Angeles. It will bring a music program to Barry J. Nindorf Juvenile Hall in Sylmar and at other facilities where youth are housed. Last month, a state board ordered some 275 youths transferred due to unsuitable conditions, but dozens will remain on the Nindorf grounds in a facility state regulators don't have jurisdiction over. David Carroll is director of the county's Department of Youth Development.
Part of our charge is just to bring down the general tension. And we believe that that musical therapy is something that can definitely help lead to just a calming, right, of the environment.
The new drum corps program will include intensive training for 30 weeks and instruction on music theory. For LAist 89.3, I'm Robert Garova.
Several Los Angeles restaurants were awarded top honors at the James Beard Awards this week. It's often called the Oscars of food. The judges highlighted Justin Peach Trugsy at Anna Jack Thai in Sherman Oaks in the Best Regional Chef category in California. Margarita Mansky of Republique in Mid-City LA was named Outstanding Pastry Chef or Baker, and an Echo Park-based sake bar, O Toto, was honored for Outstanding Wine and Other Beverages. For a list of all the winners, head to LAist.com. Coming up, on a college wait list, what does that entail? Our higher ed reporter has a closer look just ahead.
Support for LAist comes from HBO, presenting The Last of Us, a generation-defining video game, which is now a major HBO series. The hardened survivor, Joel, is hired to smuggle 14-year-old Ellie out of an oppressive quarantine zone. A brutal journey. Empire called the series a masterpiece. Emmy eligible for Outstanding Drama Series and all other categories. At the end of this podcast, you can hear a conversation with original game voice actor and series cast member, Troy Baker.
Back now to the LA Report. It's June, and some college applicants still do not know what school they're going to attend this fall. That's because they're on wait lists. LAist higher education reporter Adolfo Guzman-Lopez explains how wait lists work.
UCLA's the dream school for Mohsen Kargahi's 12th grade daughter. As of Monday, she's still on the UCLA wait list.
My daughter has been there many, many times. She has emotional connection there.
Kargahi complains the waitlist process is opaque. He's right. Elite universities post little about how those choices are made. Last year, UCLA admitted about 3% of applicants off its waitlist of over 11,000. Transferring's a better bet. UCLA says last year it admitted 24% of applicants from community colleges. Julie Pissell is a higher education researcher at USC.
The terms of transfer are definitely more transparent than the terms of first-year admission.
Pissell also said research shows most students end up happy and do just fine at schools that weren't their first choice. For LAist 89.3, I'm Adolfo Guzman-Lopez.
Tupac Shakur will be honored today with a posthumous star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. The award-winning rapper, activist, and film star addressed street violence and domestic violence against women in his music. His recording of Dear Mama is in the Library of Congress National Registry. He died young in a drive-by shooting in Las Vegas in 1996. Over two decades later, he became the first solo hip-hop artist to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Come on, come on. That's just the way it is. Never be the same.
Tupac's sister is among those attending the star unveiling today. We have cloudy skies starting off the morning hours, and then expect partly cloudy skies this afternoon with high temperatures around 70 degrees in most areas. Thank you for listening to the LA Report. The AM edition is hosted by me, Suzanne Whatley, and produced by Michael Cosentino with assistance from producer Tyler Wayne. Our engineer is Brandon Bowles. Catherine Mailhouse is the director of content development. LAist's executive editor is Megan Garvey. Original music by Scott Kelly. Check back here at 4 for the PM edition. You can read more at LAist.com or listen live anytime on the LAist app or on the radio at 89.3. FM. Listeners like you help make the LA Report possible. Please donate at laist.com/join. And the LA Report is supported by Gordon and Donna Crawford, who believe quality journalism makes Southern California a better place to live.
Support for LAist comes from HBO, presenting The Last of Us, a generation-defining video game which is now being given a big-budget television treatment on HBO. The original game features voice actors Troy Baker and Ashley Johnson, who also play roles in the TV series. Here's Troy Baker.
Something that I love about The Last of Us is that, whether it's the game or the show, it raises more questions than it answers. There's a temptation, I think, to try to answer every question that you can. And other times, it's great to just go, I don't know, why not both? And leave people in the Schrodinger's purgatory of not knowing the actual answer. Why is Ellie immune? How is it that she is the only person in the world that is not affected by this virus? Is she the only one that's not affected by this infection? To me, is one of the compelling things that keeps people in this world, because I still want to know so many things. And I think the beauty is never answering those questions.
Created by Neil Druckmann and Craig Mazin, the game and series deal with challenging themes.
It's hard to tie a pretty little bow on a story. It is an Olympic feat to do that to a tragic story. And there's going to be a lot of people that are frustrated, challenged, and wrestle over this ending. And I remember asking Neil when we shot the scene, I said, dude, you're going to piss people off. And he goes, good. Because that means they felt something. If they love it, they hate it, we did our job. They don't care about it, that's when we fail. As we end season one and we now pivot to anticipating what season two looks like, I myself as a fan start asking a lot of questions. Who do you cast as Abby? That to me is one of the biggest questions I can't wait to see, because so far, Neil and Craig have nailed the casting. Who plays Dina? What characters from the game are brought into this story? What new characters that didn't exist in the game are they going to include?
How does Troy recommend the fans prepare for the second season?
To all of those who have finished season one and are now anxiously anticipating season two, number one, I would say, if you haven't played the game, play the game. But more than anything, it's do what everybody else has been doing for the last 10 years, and that is find someone to talk about. Because that's been my favorite part, are all of the conversations that have happened in the wake of this story. And the community that has been born because of this game is probably the best byproduct.
That's Troy Baker, star of one of the most anticipated TV events of 2023. The Last of Us brings what some call the best video game story ever told to the screen. Empire called the series a masterpiece, Emmy eligible for Outstanding Drama Series and all other categories. The Last of Us is now streaming on HBO.
Ma, pa, te presento a mi novia Luna.
Hola, mucho gusto.
Eric Galindo, co-host of Wild here, and this season, I'm going to tell you a fictional love story. The type of story that feels like a movie. It was inspired by my life.
The woman I was dating, off and on again for a minute, comes to me and says she wants to move to Milwaukee.
You're looking at the newest anchor for YWCC News, baby! I'm going to be the face of Milwaukee's leading news source.
It was a road trip adventure across America. I was steeped in love and in one of the most confusing relationships of my life. This is a Southeast LA rom-com. It's the kind of fictional audio drama that forces you to confront parts of yourself.
From LA Studios, listen to Wild Season 2, I Think I'm Falling in Love. Catch the new season on NPR One, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen to podcasts.